I'm back to do some more work in Gila Springs, specifically at Gila Grains. What we're looking at, and I'll come back up here to the track plan a little bit, is I have three tracks here, and then I have this little switchback, which at the time when I installed that little switchback, I thought it was a really neat idea. I didn't have a purpose for it. Clean out track, mechanics or whatever, when I put the backdrop in place and the rest of the grain elevator. But after using this, I decided I really don't like it. And what I'd really like to do here is install a scale track right here. So that's what we're going to do. It'll become a little bit more practical, a lot more play value with it. And it's just a simple track change. Before I even get started, I need to clear out some train cars, so I'll move those out of the way right now. Keep a general idea of where my grain elevator is going to be. I'm actually going to mark it here on the bench work. Doesn't take much, just a couple little lines. This way I can get it back in roughly the same spot where I want it to be, and then we'll remove the grain elevator. Now the fun part of rearranging track is removing the old track, which is pretty much taking up track spikes. This is where using the track spikes or nails makes a lot more sense in gluing stuff down. As you test your track out, you'll find maybe you don't like something. It's easier to remove the nails and reset your track, but once you glue it in place, you've just increased your workload by a lot to find out you don't like something. So, as you've seen before, I just like to use track nails and locate all my track, and then when I come to finally ballasting everything and it's in where I like it, I'll pull them out. But for general stuff and setting up, they work great. So where I'm at now is a point where I need to decide how I want this track to look. Obviously, I'm going to put my scale house right here. Do I want to have this single track here be the entire scale track, come up around and merge up here at this turnout? Or do I want to add something like this? And this is what I'm kind of looking at doing, and I'll probably end up doing it this way. Put my turnout here for the scale house right here. Put a straight section in and a turnout there, or another curve here, so I can actually bring stuff down to the scale house, have it weighed, and shove it onto this track here, and I can pull stuff in and out here, still use this track for double duty. My one thing is I'm kind of concerned about is the way it's set up now, I'm not going to have any locomotives allowed to run across the scale for obvious reasons, they're heavy. So that's what I'm kind of deciding. If I take out this turnout here and this here, so it's just two tracks like this, you can start pushing cars down this track here, and when they're all weighed, you can pull them all out. You end up with about, I don't know, five or six cars that way. Pull them out after the weighed, bring them out to the track out here for pickup. So I'm not exactly sure what I have in mind, and probably in the next segment of the video we'll find out. But for the moment, I have not decided what I really like yet. This pattern is kind of neat. You know, gives me access to this track here or the scale track right here. And since I don't have the scale house built at the moment, I have stand-ins. So the scale house will sit somewhere right along here. In fact, I'm going to swap this track out. Conveniently, this looks like scale. We'll use that. Or I can actually put in a bigger scale house like this one here, but I've already purchased a scale shack anyway. But that's another option. Combination foreman shack, maybe, scale house. But since I've already purchased a scale house, which is about this size, that's probably what I'll go with. The elevator sits right about here. So I have a little gap here, maybe park some vehicles over here, a little parking area. And I think what I'm going to do, this will give me more options. I'm going to go with this option here. You know, it's a little more complex, but I think this will give me a little bit more options. This way, I can weigh the cars, shove them down this track here. I have a different switch out here, and I'll just check that one before I throw it in. So this switch is good. Just like with everything you do cutting wood, you measure a couple times and cut once. So what I do is I normally trim it off a little bit long for my first cut here. So I have a little bit to work with. I can line stuff up a little bit. So as you can see, it's a little bit long, but that's okay because I can trim it up from this point. I'll just trim little bits off at a time, file and fit. As you can see, it's still a little bit tight, but I'm going to file that with the Dremel. Now I'm ready to do a little work with the Dremel tool here where it's a little bit long. Wearing my safety glasses. I've got the track edges cleaned up, have the proper amount of clearance on them. I don't have any binding or anything, so I think that's good. The next step is to back cut the ties, and I just use some of these here. Fit my connectors here. Repin my track. Slide all my connectors into place. I like that. And now I'm going to install this little section right here, which will only take a minute. Now we'll fix this new section in place, and that's pretty easy. I'll just slide some of this part here a little bit. There we go. Slide the new piece into place. Pretty much that's all it is. Reinsert my locator nails. This is a little tight, so I'm going to end up taking the Dremel out and do a little Dremel work on this again. Using the Dremel doesn't hurt much, so I'll just Dremel right here on the straight track a little bit. And shorten it just a tad, so I'm not as tight. All the track should sit back in the same place where it was before, so it's just pretty much sliding all the track nails back into their holes to lock the track in place for now. Now I'll finish this off because the new switch didn't have any locator pins. So I'll do that. the other nail in to locate it in place so it's nice and solid and won't go anywhere. And I'll finish it off with the new sections of track too. Pretty much all that's left to do is just push the nails down in place. Make sure nothing's sticking up. Looks pretty good. Put a new scale house there and start putting things back into place. At the hobby shop, I did pick up some new N-scale cars from Microtrains, and I have some Fox Valley cars I'll show you in a little bit. So let's start with this first Microtrains car. It's a 61 bulkhead flat car. It's a Golden West service car. Its number is 459001, and it runs about 2675. I normally don't go out and buy new cars, but these new bulkhead flat cars are really nice. I mean, they've been around for Microtrains for a long time. But the key thing that they've done with these new cars is the load. They have two new loads for each car, for the Southern Pacific and the Golden West service car. It's just a really nice load. I hope they release these in individual packs and everything, because I have a whole bunch of cars that these could be used in. But that there is the Golden West service car, and we'll pull up the next one in line. This is also the Microtrains car. It's the 61 bulkhead flat car. It's a Southern Pacific version, and it's 508422. Another great little car. I bought both of them. This one here runs 2435. It's probably due to the fact there's less colors on it than the Golden West service bulkhead flat. But same thing. Removable load. I really hope that they come out with the removable loads in individual packs. I have a handful of these 61-foot bulkhead flat cars for Microtrains anyway that could use new loads. But in fact, I'll take a sample load. I have another one sitting there in the back just for a variety of different loads you can run on the car. And here's one of my favorite loads right here. These are from Hayes Brothers. These are the giant tire loads. I don't have the part number for them, but they're Hayes Brothers, and you can usually find these on sale on eBay. Great little load for this car. Considering that I model in Arizona, runs through the mines and everything. There's the car again with its load that it came with. Really nice little car. Our next car is another Microtrain car. It is the BC Rail car. It is a 50-foot ribside box car with plug and a sliding door. Its number is 100348. This is a really nice car too. I normally wouldn't pick up a box car, but I really like this car. It looks good. But it does have its little issues on it, which when you open it up, Microtrains did such a great job, but I don't know if you can see it or not. The model is done in a forest green plastic. I don't know if you can see that here. Let me try to hold that in the camera. So if you have the door open, you have forest green plastic on the inside. I don't know why they did not paint the sliding doors on the model. Inside, they actually painted the inside of the model itself. Hold that better there. I'm trying to juggle with the camera. I don't know why they didn't paint the inside of the doors. So, but most of the time you're gonna run with the door shut anyway, so. Other than that, it's a really nice model. The lettering's all really nice. It still runs on the Microtrain trucks. Just a good, outstanding little model. And this one here is another expensive one. You know, they run it for $26. It's one of those deals to where if you don't get it now, you probably will never get it. So I ended up getting it anyway. The final two cars I have are the Soline, or Suline, whatever you want to call them, box cars from Fox Valley Models. They call them their, let me see what they call them here, their Sioux 7-post box car. Really nice car. The detail on these cars is outstanding. They do have etched metal running boards on them, which you can't see. I'm not going to pick it up off the track. I've already knocked enough stuff over to do that. Really nice little car. All the detail and the printing's really nice. The only thing bad about the printing is the letters are awfully shiny, but if you slap a coat of dull coat on, it will fix them up, and most people will weather them anyway a little bit. So that should fix it up. Really nice car. And its sister's car is a white and red version. Same thing. Nice detail on them. In fact, if you take out your jeweler's loop, if you have one, the detail, you can actually read what's in these little black boxes here. So they took a lot of time printing the fine detail and everything. And like I said, this car here has the etched metal running boards on the ends and everything. And that car, since I forgot to tell you what number it is number, and I don't even have it here, 16843. So, and these cars, this is actually FVM8169-2, and the other one is FVM8162-3. So, they've already had a couple cars in this series come out earlier, so you can see where I'm at in the series, but I don't need many of these. You know, it's different area in the layout, but it's still a nice little car. So here's what we got. I'll run them backwards for you. The Soline by Fox Valley Models, white and red. The Soline again by Fox Valley Models, brown and white. The Microtrains BC Rail, really nice car. Other than the fact they didn't paint the inside of the sliding doors, you can live with that if you keep your door shut. It's just something that I would have thought they'd have done on like a $26-something model. They could have taken the time to paint the inside of the door. Also a Microtrain line, their Southern Pacific 61-foot bulkhead flat car with removable load. Still a good quality car. I think the key is the removable load. That is a nice load, and if you have more of them, it's just a great load. I hope Microtrains releases this load in individual packages. I have about, 10, 20 of these cars running on the layout, and they all have different little loads on them, but coming out from a mill or something like that, it would be great. I don't know why they did the load in dark wood like that. They could have done it in a light pine looking wood, but that's what they chose. They're not actually railroad ties on this load either. They do have a load that is railroad ties, and this is not. This is actually beams. The final Microtrain model is the other 61-foot bulkhead flat car for Golden West Service. Same thing, removable load. You know, could have been done in a lighter color for pine. But other than that, it's a great car. So keep up the good work, and obviously they did something right because I purchased three of their cars new right out of the hobby shop, which I normally don't do.